Fennell sign in thoracic outlet syndrome. Firstly, let me suggest that in my opinion, thoracic outlet syndrome is an underdiagnosed condition. Whenever a patient presents with paresthesia in the fourth and fifth fingers of the hand, with symptoms arising in the shoulder area, one must always consider the possibility of thoracic outlet syndrome, particularly if there is difficulty in doing overhead work, and importantly, if there is a history of coldness or color changes in the hand. I will leave a discussion of thoracic outlet syndrome for another talk, but would like to emphasize a clinical sign which I find very useful and I would suggest is present in one-third to one-half of the patients whom I have felt have had a thoracic outlet syndrome. Tapping in the supraclavicular region over a fairly wide area will occasionally produce paresthesias radiating down into the fourth and fifth fingers of the hand. Not only paresthesias, but the patient will often feel intense discomfort and complain of nausea. Another interesting observation is that even before the patient says anything, occasionally the little and ring fingers will flex, as often happens when you percuss the ulnar nerve in cases of ulnar neuritis. So, complaints of paresthesias in the little and ring fingers, with symptoms arising in the shoulder region, difficulty in keeping the arms elevated, and coldness or color changes in the hand, associated with clinical findings of a positive Roux test, positive Tennell sign in the supraclavicular region, and if there is a vascular component, then a disappearing radial pulse, often before the coronal plane is reached. I would suggest that these are fairly typical symptoms and signs of thoracic outlet syndrome. I will discuss this condition in more detail in a future talk. Measurement of hind foot inversion and eversion. AMA5 describes the range of movement and how to measure that range of movement for every joint in the upper and lower extremities, excepting for inversion and eversion of the hind foot or subtalar joint. I would like to suggest a very accurate and simple method of doing this, which I suggest is accurate to 1 degree. You will need to use this type of goniometer with a fulcrum centered on the ankle joint, which actually happens automatically. The proximal arm of the goniometer lies against the medial aspect of the distal leg and the distal arm along the medial aspect of the calcaneus. Once you get used to using this method, you will see that the goniometer will only go in one and the same position. Here is a close-up of the starting position, which will always be in inversion because of the anatomy. In this instance, we measure 20 degrees, which is our starting point. And at maximal inversion, which needs to be active assisted range of movement. I will mention this again in a moment. And here is a close-up showing a reading of 30 degrees. The actual range of inversion then is 30 minus 20, giving 10 degrees of inversion. And testing eversion, and a close-up showing 4 degrees. The range of eversion then is 20 minus 4, giving 16 degrees. I'm not sure how you find testing for subtalar range, but I often find that there is no active or passive eversion present. This emphasizes the instruction in AMA 5 to always compare range of motion with the opposite slide. With regard to range of movement, the guides are very clear that only active range of movement can be used for assessing impairment. I find that I'm often required to carry out assisted active range of movement, as in this example. Imagine asking a patient who is lying supine, looking at the roof to maximally invert your hind foot. You'll wait all day for that to happen. Similarly, when examining for internal and external rotation of the hip, with the patient face down on the examining couch, as required by AMA 5, how far do you think you'll get with please maximally internally rotate your left hip? You will be forgiven for using active assisted range of movement in these and similar situations. And finally, the measurement of true and apparent shortening. Usually on one's first day as an orthopedic registrar, and certainly within the first week, one needs to know all about shortening, as it is so common and so important. I am aware that this does not apply as emphatically in other specialties. With regard to the methods of measuring for shortening, the most commonly described method is to measure the distance from the anterior superior iliac spine to the tip of the medial malleolus with the patient supine as shown here. However, I find the standing method using blocks as being more accurate. I use these blocks of 0.5 centimeter, 1, 1.5, and 2 centimeters, so that one gets 0.5 centimeter increments up to 5 centimeters. It is also a 5 centimeter block. The next few slides will show how accurate this method is. Here is a person with equal leg lengths, and you can see the fingers placed on the iliac crest are at the same level. In this slide, the right side has been raised on a 1 centimeter block, and look at the obvious difference. And here raised 2 centimeters. This is a very accurate way to measure leg lengths. I will always check my measurement with the patient recumbent using the anterior superior iliac spine to medial malleolus method. Now we come to the slightly confusing true versus apparent shortening. If you look at example B, you can see that the left leg is shorter than the right. If you can then confirm that the pelvis is square and the legs are parallel, then you have what is called true shortening. If you look at example A, the diagram on the left shows an adduction contracture of the left hip, such that when the pelvis is square, the left leg crosses over the right leg. There is no way that the person can walk in this position, and the only way he or she can walk is to get the legs parallel, and the only way to do that is to hitch the pelvis up on the same left side. The person can now walk, and the legs are parallel, but the pelvis is not square. So the left leg appears to be short, even though it is not. This is what is termed apparent shortening. The way to measure apparent shortening is either by using blocks or measuring from a central landmark, such as the umbilicus or the Ziffer sternum. In this example, the man in the diagram on the right has a fixed adduction contracture of his right hip, and the only way he can get his legs parallel in order to be able to walk is to hitch his pelvis up on the right side, giving apparent shortening. And in this final slide, the man on the left has a fixed abduction contracture of his left hip, and the only way to get his legs parallel is to hitch up his pelvis on the opposite right side, giving apparent lengthening of the affected leg. Before we end, let me give you two things to think about before the next session. Firstly, as mentioned earlier, can one have a flexion contracture and an extension lag in the same patient? Secondly, I was once at a lecture given by a neurologist who suggested, as he described it, a pearl. He asked whether we could suggest a clinical sign that would enable one to distinguish between an L5 nerve root lesion and a common peroneal nerve lesion. In the light of this talk and our last talk, can you suggest 2 clinical signs to distinguish between these 2 conditions? I hope that you found this talk useful, and once again, thank you for your attention, and I hope you will join me again in a month's time. Salani Gashle.